morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship. Glad that you chose to be with us on this bright and sunny day. Thank you for the sunshine. Just a couple of announcements to call to your attention. The Word in Season is available back in the entryway. So if you would like one of those or know somebody you can deliver them to, please make sure you pick those up. We cut back our order, and I know there are some who still would like to receive the Word in Season. So if you don't get one, please let us know, and at least for the next order, we can try to add on. We were having a lot of those adding up, and we were throwing away a lot of those, so we cut back, but we maybe need to add some more. I know some people haven't received them. Also, then, a reminder about our Lent and Midweek services. Those are by faith. We're looking at those folks in our past, those of Scripture in particular, who are people of faith, who show faith, and who live that faith out into the world. So, I think those are the only announcements. Thanks to Tim Concept, our soloist of the choir, who will be singing our prelude. So let's listen as we prepare ourselves for worship.
Thank you.
Please stand for our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer.
Amen.
God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who is full of compassion. Fountain of living water, pour out your mercy over us. Our sin is heavy, and we long to be free. Rebuild what we have ruined, and mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing blood. Make us alive in the Spirit, to follow in the way of Jesus, as healers and restorers of the world you so love. Beloved, God's word never fails. The promise rests on grace. By the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power of God, your sins are forgiven, and God remembers them no more. Journey in the way of Jesus.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Seek the Lord while he may be found.
Call upon God while he is near.
Wicked, forsake your thoughts.
Return to the Lord.
Come back to God.
Return to the Lord.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
Amen.
Let us pray. Rejoicing, Father, you celebrate when one of your lost children is found, because no one is worthless to you. We stand humbled and in awe that you would count us among your most prized possessions. Give us eyes to see the priceless value of every living soul for the sake of the one who became human, for the sake of our souls. Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
First reading is from Psalm 119, beginning at the 167th verse. I have obeyed your laws, for I love them very much. Yes, I obey your commandments and laws, because you know everything I do. O Lord, listen to my cry. Give me the discerning mind you promised. Listen to my prayer. Rescue me as you promised. Let praise flow from my lips, for you have taught me your decrees. Let my tongue sing about your word, for all your commands are right. Give me a helping hand,
for I have chosen to follow your commandments. O Lord, I have longed for your rescue, and your instructions are my delight. Let me live so I can praise you, and may your regulations help me. I have wandered away like a lost sheep. Come and find me, for I have not forgotten your commands. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him. And the Pharisees and scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I have lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that belongs to me.' So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country, and there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would have gladly filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. While he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, and get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command, yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, you guys devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Christ, mercy and peace to you, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, who was, who is, and who is to come, the Alpha and the Omega. Amen. So, first off, I have a question for all of you, and please respond. It's okay. We can interact here. How many of you have ever lost something? Raise your hand. Yeah, that's kind of a no-brainer, right? Yeah, kind of a no-brainer. Whether it be keys, where are my keys? Or my wallet? Two things. says, I don't know. Where did you last put them? And then, of course, and then the phone. Yeah, thank you. And then the phone. I have this little thing on my Fitbit that I can press if I'm losing my phone, and it goes beep, 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 beep. I mean, just obnoxiously so. We humans spend a lot of time and money avoiding being lost, don't we? Amber system alerts, so important along the highway. Sober alerts, reminding people. Weather alerts, when there is terrible weather that is coming or has been predicted. There are phones, of course, that track us. There are keys that are lost. There, in fact, I think you can do one of these popping things, and the keys starts buzzing again obnoxiously. Or lost wallets.
Earrings.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, earrings. Okay. Microchips in pets. Again, a very, very important thing. If our pet wanders off or runs away, those microchips can help find that precious member of the family. In our text today, Jesus is dealing with Pharisees and scribes, and he is talking about lost things. I think about the lost boys of Peter Pan. You ever been lost? And then do you go get directions? Of course, with phones now, but those don't always work. I got to a place that was right in front of a bridge, and I was supposed to go see a person in a house. And the directions took me right in front or under a bridge, actually. It's a humbling experience being lost. Maybe you've been lost as you went for a walk somewhere and didn't know the territory and it was getting dark. And you were panicking because you felt lost. The Pharisees and scribes, as I said, are grumbling about Jesus. That dude welcomes sinners and eats with them. How dare he? How dare he? Those prostitutes, those tax collectors, those people, those widows, those people we don't really want to deal with. But that's what Jesus does, isn't it? And then he tells these wonderful stories. Stories sometimes are better than shaking our fingers at our children. Telling the story, although my daughter would roll her eyes and say, I know, I know, I know. Tells the story of a shepherd. Shepherd who leaves 99. I often thought, well, what about those 99? Who's going to take care of them? But he goes out and finds the one. Those 99 are still without a leader. And then this woman who loses a coin. And there's this frantic search. We all know what that's like, whether it's a phone or keys or a wallet or a child who's walked away from us when we're in a department store, although that's probably not been done very much lately. We all know what that's like. We frantically look for the thing that we've lost. What Jesus really wants to tell the Pharisees and scribes is that it is about what God is doing for those people who are lost. God sees everyone. first and foremost as the child of God. That even means the grumpy Walmart clerk who's been waiting on us and doesn't even seem to smile. That even means the drug dealer. That even means the thieves and the cheating taxpayers. That even means those people who have been worn out from the effects of drugs and families. We see them not for the bad they've done or the bad choices they've made, but the way God sees them. And I think that's what Jesus and why he tells these stories. And one of the most important stories of all Scripture, one that we know and cherish, that story of the father with two sons. See, interestingly enough, the elder son really is like the Pharisees. He's the righteous one. He's the one who does everything right and makes all the good choices and gives up himself for the sake of the family. But that younger just wants his stuff from the dad and goes and does what he does. He goes away. He chooses in many ways to be lost, to be separated from the family, to be separated from something that we cherish, like the woman who's looking for that coin, or the shepherd who leaves behind the 99 to find the one. We are those people who sometimes are lost, you and me. There are some ways and some days and many days we're like the lost. We float around wondering about things in life and in our family's life and in our friend's life. We wonder about God. We have doubt about God. It is now famous book, Brian McLaren, Faith After Doubt. Faith After Doubt. He talks about how doubt is part of who we are. At the end of Matthew's gospel, Matthew says, some worship, they worship Jesus, but some doubted. Well, the text isn't very clear there in the English, but it's some worshiped and doubted. So there's these challenging things within each and every one of us. And what Jesus does and encourages those Pharisees and those scribes and those of us who are lost from time to time is to repent. And repentance doesn't always mean that we get on our knees and we ask for forgiveness. It's part of it. But this sense of repentance is turning back to what God wants. And what God wants is to embrace you like that hen embraces the little chicks when there's fear around. It means to be claimed by the one that loves you unconditionally without any merit. It encourages us to go back to the relationships that primary in our lives, relationship that God has formed and has molded and has been with you through all of life. It's the absolute will of the Father and Mother God that reminds us that we see others not for the things that they do or don't do, but the way that God sees them. It'd be interesting, wouldn't it, if wherever we go or whoever we interact with during our day, we see them as a child of God. We see them as God sees them, broken, yet loved and forgiven, just like us. What a world we would have, right? What a world we would have. God and God's grace is always available. We realize, and what we do then is is like God in the story of the father and two sons. I can imagine the father going day after day after day, wondering where his son is, going to the hillside and looking at nightfall and seeing, is he there? Is that him? That's to see what God does for us. God embraces us with God's grace. It is always available, and we then realize, recognize, and embrace it, knowing that God has embraced us. Amen.
Beloved friends, in this season of repentance and healing, we accept God's invitation to be ever mindful of the needs of others, offering our prayers on behalf of God's community and the church and the world. Help the leaders of countries, O God, to seek out the lost and oppressed. Set our minds on justice and peace that the world may better reflect your kingdom and rule. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Rescue the lost, O God, no matter how or why they may be lost. Please bring them into healthy and supportive communities and surround them with love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Find and strengthen those who heal, O God. Work in and through them to share your comfort and healing, especially with LaDonna, Marissa, Ann, Charles, Marty, Ernie, Helen, Judy, Alan, Jackie, Therese, Brian, Jocelyn, Mike, Mary, the McMillan family, Bill, and Linda. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Help us, O God, to search for those around us in any sort of need. Open our eyes to your presence and the people around us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Fill us with your strength to resist the seductions of our foolish desires and the tempter's vain delights, that we may walk in obedience and righteousness, rejoicing in you with an upright heart.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, receive the gifts we give as you receive us. Like a mother receives her child with arms open wide, nourish us anew in your tender care and empower us in faithful service to show love to our neighbors with these gifts, given as an expression of our gratitude for all you have blessed us with as faithful servants of Christ here at your church, St. Paul Lutheran.
Amen. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence, in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. O God, creator of our wilderness world, savior of the lost, and comforter of the sick and suffering, we give you thanks for your everlasting might. We glorify you for your covenant of mercy. For 40 days you cleanse the earth with the waters of the flood, and for 40 days you illumine Moses with the words of your law. And for 40 years you fed your people with manna from heaven. We praise you, O God.
We praise you, O God.
You became truly human in Jesus, our brother. For 40 days with fasting and prayer, you renounced the power of the devil. On the night before he died, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We extol his life, we lament his death, we celebrate his resurrection. Amen.
Amen.
Transform us, O God, with your lively spirit. Make this food into manna for our journey, the body and blood of your Son. Save us, O God.
Save us, O God.
Grant us with the Ninevites 40 days of repentance. Save us, O God.
Save us, O God.
Teach us your words of wisdom and justice. Save us, O God.
Save us, O God.
By the grace of God, we are bold to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
Please stand as we say together our post-communion hymn. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to be given to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Let us pray. God of steadfast love, at this table, you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit, that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, free to serve your neighbor. God bless you that you may be a blessing in the same way. In the name of the Holy and Life-Giving Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to share the good news.
Thanks be to God.